Over. This is the 2015 kickoff to the SOPA Conference, Street Preachers Conference here in Atlanta. We now have a show and tell event going on.
This is what we call early Christmas.
Early
Peter
Christmas.
Peter actually got this for me as a gift.
Oh,
and
wow.
So, hey, this is gorgeous. So the sad part is when I look at something like this, it's just going to be destroyed. But we are definitely going to use it. This thing has access. It goes... put the speakers different ways, and so we're going to try to modify it to make it fit a good backpack. And these are definitely tools that we definitely love.
Wow.
But this is great.
Now, where do you get something like that?
Germany. Thank the Germans.
There you go.
I mean, I want to go out and buy a Mercedes-Benz after something like this. This is great.
This is what you call street preacher.
Oh, yes.
It's a shirt that's in the back.
Oh, there they were. And I said, what is going on there? He was out there on that corner. And he was a freaking mild man. And all of a sudden,
you're not in California. You know you're in Georgia when this is behind a pulpit. Let me tell you, if you're a heretic or a homo, don't come to a church in Georgia that believes in the Bible. This right here is what keeps Muslims at bay. And so, God bless Georgia. I wish my state would be as faithful as that. How often do you see this behind a pulpit? You know you're in Georgia.
Wow.
So, we'll fly this on the campus.
Man, that is one big laundry list.
This is a nice band. This one ought to get some attention.
They are flying their name somewhere.
First of all, I want to thank everybody for doing a good job on campus today. You guys looked awesome. These students, when they walked into the pit and they saw a line full of banners, a wall full of banners, and everybody had their own little crowd around them. You couldn't ask for anything better than that.
Amen.
And so they're still talking about it.
Yeah.
My advice to you is they're going to have 24 hours to think about what happened.
Yeah.
And expect a little bit more incoming tomorrow.
That's right.
And expect even more on Friday.
Amen.
And so we caught them off guard.
Yeah.
It was kind of like a Pearl Harbor there on that campus. But they know we're coming back tomorrow.
Yeah.
And so they're going to be prepared a little bit more.
Right.
But I want to thank you guys for doing this. I'd like to start off with a little intro. Make sure your cell phones are off, please, for the other men behind me as well. When you get a chance to speak at a conference like this, it is a little bit difficult. First of all, you know you're at a street preacher conference when there's no mic, and you're told to go ahead and speak. There's no mic up here. And so, but when you speak at a conference like this, you have to understand, you got guys who have been doing this for quite some time, and guys who just got started. And so, trying to teach guys who have opened their preach something is almost like trying to be a coach at an NBA All-Star team. These guys, they're millionaires, and you want to try to teach them something? It's very difficult to teach and edify a lot of men because, God's used them, and what are you going to say to me? And so I like to teach a little bit before I get into my sermon on how to actually have church.
Hallelujah.
Doesn't matter how old you are in the Lord, I'm going to give you a quick Bible reference on how to have church. And I take this in the Last Supper with Jesus. Here Jesus Christ is with 12 men who followed him for 3 years, and our Lord at the table said, one of you will betray me. The Bible says they each said, is it I? Am I the one? Are you talking to me? They didn't say, it was probably Peter. We all heard Jesus say, get thee behind me, Satan.
Yeah.
And probably Thaddeus. He's got shifty eyes. Thomas is always doubting. Those men who followed Jesus for 3 years said, "Is it I?" That's how you have church. If you came here with something on your shoulders, you're not going to get fed. Everything that gets said from this pulpit, from every preacher, you need to say, "Is it me? Are you talking to me?" The disciples actually said, "Is it I?" Even when Judas left the table, they thought he was on an errand for Jesus. There was no, "He's not talking to me." You go into churches today, and the minister gives a sermon. "I think he's talking about Sister Betsy over there. Yeah, I think he's talking about this brother over here."
Come on.
That's how you have church. "Is it me? Lord, are you talking to me?" So I don't care how long you've been saved, that's how you have church.
Yeah.
Amen.
I also would like to exhort these speakers. If Brother Dick has commissioned you to speak, like I said, you are preachers.
Yes.
And usually I sit in the back and I'm observing. And it is always shocking to me to have a preacher come up and read notes as though this is recital. Guys, hand me a handout if you're going to just be reading. Okay, you shouldn't have this space and sound like this. Jane and Dick, run. Run, Jane, run. See, Spot, run. You should be able to preach. I've got notes, but my notes are just to keep me on track.
Yeah.
Okay? I don't do this. Otherwise, I'd give you all a handout and save a whole lot of time.
Yeah.
The notes are to keep me on track.
Yeah.
But you have to understand, if Brother Dick gave you a window, you better utilize that. You're a preacher. You better know what you're talking about. You better act and preach as though you know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Not recital. Anybody can do a recital. You are given a commission, and much like if God commissions you to go someplace and preach, we don't stand there and recite this stuff.
Right.
You should know exactly what you're talking about.
Come on, preach.
I understand notes. I understand. But you ought to have your notes. Just simply keep you on track. Yeah. My notes are kind of caveman. You probably wouldn't even understand it. It's kind of like in my own code. But it's just simply to keep me on track as to what I want to communicate.
Yeah.
And oftentimes, most of us get involved in teaching and trying to recite something. You need to actually be in prayer. As soon as Dick tells me I've got 3 slots, hey, it's taken care of. If he says you have 20 minutes, I'll knock it out in 15.
Go ahead.
It's not that big of a thing. You're preachers. If he says, "Hey, somebody backed out, Ruben, you have another slot," not a problem.
Yeah.
I'm a preacher, for crying out loud.
Yeah.
It doesn't take much to go there. It's not like I need notes.
Right.
And again, we're teaching men who want to go out and preach. This is very difficult. It's not like a Sunday school where you have, young believers. You've got guys who believe they're used of God. And so when you have this window up here, you better not be reciting stuff.
Amen.
Anybody can do that. Speak as though you believe what you're doing.
Amen.
That's the concept.
Yeah.
And so for those of you sitting down, is it I? Are you talking about me?
Come on.
And for those of you who are commissioned to use this pulpit, understand this isn't third grade. You're speaking to some seasoned people here.
Right.
And so speak as though you actually know what you're talking about. If all you're going to do is just read, do me a favor and don't waste my time. Give me a hand up and get somebody else that will actually take the job.
Come on.
And so this is the way God is.
Yeah.
This is the pressure I have from God. When God sends me out, it's not recital. It's to convey a message to people that I'm supposed to. And so you ought to be in prayer. I normally don't have a lot of amens and hallelujahs when I preach.
Yeah.
I don't have a lot of, can I get an amen? I don't have a lot of a glory to God. So those are like filling words.
Yeah.
I know what I'm going to say, and I'm going to say it whether you like it or not.
Yeah.
That's what God has us to say.
Right.
And so there's not a whole lot of filling words with me. I'm pretty much blunt and to the point. And this is the way I find men of God in the Bible do it.
Yeah.
And so with that, I'd like to discuss a little bit about some preaching pearls. These are things that I've noticed over the years. And these are things that I think we all need to know every once in a while.
Yeah.
Every time I've heard some young preachers, I've always heard, hey, brother. Calling heathen brother is wrong.
Come on.
Well, I understand that. That's wrong.
Right.
I know it's very popular to say, hey, bro. But words mean something. Words mean something to me.
Amen.
The word Christian in the King James Bible is mentioned 3 times. It's not a word that's loosely used over and over and over.
Wow.
Words do mean things.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ said, my sister, brother, and mother are those who do the will of God.
Right.
You are of your father, the devil.
Yeah.
And so for us to start calling people brother, something's wrong with our preaching. Street preacher, you need to clean that stuff up. You can't go out there and call that guy a brother.
Right.
He's not your brother.
Right.
Have you lost the definition of that word brother?
Yeah.
That's supposed to mean something.
Yeah.
In the book of Acts, we have men of God who actually preached men and brethren.
That's right.
They had it together.
Yeah.
It's in the Bible. The field manual's there. It's not complicated. So for us to call people brothers, you need to clean that up when you're out there.
Yeah.
I don't have the same father they do.
Come on.
Right. Does it sound arrogant?
Come on.
You say you can call it arrogant. It's just confident.
Right.
I have a different father.
Yeah.
I'm not going to hell. My sins are forgiven.
Amen.
I have the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
I have the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
My name is written in heaven.
Amen.
You're not the same father if you don't believe in Jesus as the Son of God.
Yeah.
But it's very popular today.
Yeah.
Hey, bro. Hey, brother.
Yeah.
Clean that up.
Right. Good word, brother.
Another word that I constantly hear, especially among the young believers, is the word, can I be honest? You need to terminate that from your vocabulary.
Right.
Can I be honest? That means everything that you've said up until that point is a flat lie.
Right.
You need to abort that from your vocabulary if you're going to go out there and preach about Jesus and people getting saved or going to hell. You know, don't ever say, honestly, that means everything from that point has been a lie.
Yeah.
Clean that up. You can't get out there and talk about Jesus Christ and what he's going to do and then say, can I be honest about where you're going to go? Well, you should have been honest where the guy's going to go.
Yeah.
Never say, can I be honest? Clean that up.
That's good.
We have something called a cosmetic Christian. These guys just love to do things for YouTube.
Right.
And I hope there's none here. What you do have is you have some young street preachers who preach just primarily for YouTube.
Right.
In Los Angeles, we've always been preaching at the Academy Awards for going on 35 years. And there's some young believers that go out there and they have the camera in front of them and they're looking at the camera and they're saying, I'm not like those guys over there. I have more love. I care about their soul. I don't do what they do. And so they actually give about a 20-minute sermon on how they're not like us as the limos are going by them.
Right, yeah.
Now, the person on YouTube that's watching it, he's getting edified, but we're there for the limos. We're not there to have a disclaimer. We're not there to say, I'm not like those guys.
Right.
I'm like these guys. As a matter of fact, if my presence, which sometimes it does, they will modify their whole preaching. They'll preach about me to heathen.
Right.
It's amazing.
Right.
It's amazing. Why would they do that? If they were filled with the Holy Ghost,
that's right.
Why would I have to influence what they have to say?
Yeah.
And so what they're doing it for is nothing more than YouTube.
There you go.
It's the spirit of the Pharisees who prayed on the streets just to be seen of men.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
I preach the way I've always preached, whether there's a camera there
right.
or no camera there.
Yeah.
Right.
I'm very, you know, personal when I get into my preaching.
Yeah.
And so whether there's a camera there or not.
Yeah.
And so I'm not going to be talking about how I'm not like those guys. Doesn't matter who's there.
Yeah.
But you have these guys who just love to preach for simply the sake of YouTube. Well, you got students walking around you. There was this one guy on campus. He had a 30-minute YouTube clip, 20 minutes of that, of how he's not like those guys over there, how he doesn't have a sign like those guys over there. Students are walking by.
Yeah.
It was just for YouTube.
Yeah.
I don't have a problem with having something for YouTube, but do it at a desk.
Right.
Do it at your house. When you're there on the street, you're supposed to be preaching to people.
Amen.
Not using them as a backdrop.
Right. Amen.
You got to clean that up.
That's good, brother.
Oftentimes we're told, you got bad motive.
No.
Your motive's bad, brother. You don't know your motive is wicked and horrible. And oftentimes this does affect people. And oftentimes you'll have guys, when they go out and preach, they have to explain their motive to sinners. You don't know what it took to be here for you.
Yeah.
You don't know I came from another state to preach for you.
Yeah.
You don't know what I had to do to get here.
Whoa.
And so that's going to win over a student.
Right.
If they're going to not accept God for God's love, you think they're going to come to Christ because you showed up from another state?
Yeah.
If we go out there to try to explain our motive, you bit that apple. I can care less what people think.
Right.
The day I am concerned what others think about me is the day I hang up my megaphone.
Sure. Yeah.
And let me tell you, after 35 years, they're not going to find scandals. They're not going to find stuff. After 35 years of preaching, well, brother, we just don't like your song. Well, hey, I can live with that. After 35 years, that's the only thing they nail you on, which, believe me, they're out there. Hey, I'll take it.
Yeah.
But I don't need to go out there. Jonah never walked in Nineveh. You people have no idea what it took to get me here to tell you 40 days and no more Nineveh.
Right.
You have no idea what I had to go through.
That's right. Come on.
Yeah.
Right.
You don't need to do that. You bit the apple. Who cares what your motive is? I'm assuming your motive is right. I'm assuming your motive is serving God.
Yeah.
But when you feel that you're obligated, that you need to explain your motive to heathen, you bit that apple. You are more concerned
right.
about what they're thinking.
Yeah.
Who cares what they think about you?
Yeah.
Who really cares?
Right.
I believe that God will honor your work if it's done rightfully. But God's the one that's going to test you.
That's right.
And in regards to motive, here's Paul. This is what Paul says. Knowing, therefore, the terror of the Lord,
amen.
We persuade men.
Amen.
That was Paul's motive.
There you go.
I'm persuading men, not because I love them, not because I just have so much concern for them, because of the terror of the Lord.
Yeah.
You want motive? If Paul expose this on Facebook or YouTube, most people wouldn't be associating with Paul.
Right.
That's Bible.
Yeah.
That was Paul's motive. You want to know why he persuades people? It's because he understands the terror of God.
Yeah.
That's motive. Yeah. Nothing wrong with that.
Come on.
But when you feel obligated that you need to explain to people motive. Oh, I care for you. I love you. You know, there's nobody in the Bible that actually went out there and spent more time. You guys, I just really love you. You don't understand. When you do that, you're muddying up your testimony.
Right.
Who cares what they think about you?
Yeah.
You ought to be more concerned about God.
There you go.
Another pearl I'd like to toss out to you for you to consume is a weeping Christian. The Christian that just loves to preach and say, you don't know how much I love you. You don't know how much I love you. I don't have a problem with that. But if you're going to weep, weep for God.
Yeah. Yeah.
Weep for God, not the heathen. When I read Bible, man, I feel sorry for God.
Yeah.
Nobody ever mentions that God has emotion.
Right. That's right.
Nobody ever brings up the fact that God was grieved.
Right.
It grieved God he made man.
That's right.
So if you're going to cry, how about crying for God?
Amen.
How about weeping for God? How about saying, I'm more concerned about God?
Yeah.
Oh, he feels horrible in what you've done.
Right.
But instead, we want to look like we're concerned. And so I'm surprised most preachers don't have onion-scented sleeves. So when they wipe it, they get... Yeah. We're not there to cry for the heathen. If you're going to cry, cry for God.
Amen.
God's the one. I feel sorry for God. He offers us eternal life. He's given us His Holy Ghost. He's given us His written word. And mankind is still spinning.
Yeah.
How about getting your priorities order and saying, I have sympathy towards God.
Yeah.
I'm not concerned. You ain't ever going to hear me crying out for people.
Good word, brother.
God is the one that gets my sympathy.
Amen.
God's the one that I'm concerned about. God's the one that I'm weeping over.
Mom.
Wow. God actually regretted making man. Making man. God telling Israel, I'm going to divorce you.
Yeah.
God telling Moses, move aside. I'm going to wipe these people out. And this was his chosen people.
Right. Yeah.
This was his chosen people.
Yeah.
And so when I see heathen, my sympathy goes towards God.
Yes.
Call me odd, but that's where my sympathy
goes. Amen.
You don't have men of God showing up weeping for crying for people. Understand, if you're going to cry, weep towards God.
That's good.
He's the one that actually has put up and given up so much. He's the one that gets quenched. He's the one that gave his son.
Amen.
Yeah.
You just give up a few hours on a weekend.
Yeah.
He gave up his son.
Yeah.
And you have the gall to stand there and tell sinners what you've given up? Clean that up.
Come on.
You need to clean that up when you get out there.
That's good, brother. Amen.
One last point I'd like to make is a bickering among ourselves.
Yeah.
You know, again, as we mentioned earlier, when I go out and preach, I do work with a large group of guys. When I travel, I don't just go with a basic preach button. Usually there's a lot of people that want to work with us. And so we have people flying in and busing in. And, we work with your very legalist Baptist to your most wild-eyed Pentecostal. And so, but when we're out in the street, the theme is repentance.
Yeah.
Okay, I don't hear the Pentecostal saying, you need to speak in tongues or you're not saved.
Right. Yeah, right.
He keeps that kind of kidding to himself.
Yeah.
I don't hear the Baptist saying, you need to get baptized under my church or God's not even going to recognize it.
Yeah.
He keeps that to himself.
Yeah.
When we're out there, the theme is repentance.
Yeah. Yeah.
The theme is pointing out sin.
Yeah.
And so oftentimes I'm always like, well, how can you handle all these guys, brother? Well, that's the theme. As I said, when we go out, we usually have a little pep talk, a Matthew 10 meeting, get everybody on the same page, and so it's a lot easier, because we're not arguing theology.
Right.
And let me tell you, after working these guys for 12 hours in the street, they're not going to argue much after a good day of preaching.
Right.
They are absolutely exhausted. And so understand, this is how I'm able to do it. But even a man who believes in the rapture and somebody who doesn't believe in the rapture, that's not an issue when we're out there to get the unsaved saved.
Right.
You keep those people on the same page. When you go out there, that's the concept. Keep them on the same page as found in Matthew chapter 10.
Yes.
Matthew chapter 10, Jesus sent his disciples. He told them what to preach. He told them where to go. He said what city not to even walk in. They were all on the same page.
Right.
And so when you work with a group of men and women, you want to keep them on the same page.
Yes.
Theology does matter.
Yes.
And we'll handle it when we get back. But after about 12 hours of plowing the field, after about 12 hours of putting your body in harm's way,
well,
I'm going to tell you something. I've had brothers who disagree with theology like you wouldn't believe actually weep and cry after they spent about 5 days doing some of the places that we do. And so it's easy to say you'll lay down your life. Some of the places and cities in our country today, you have no idea the amount of hatred that's out there towards the gospel.
Yeah.
And so when you get these men, even from different churches, they do actually stick together because the theme is repentance and being born again.
Yeah.
That's the concept.
Yeah.
And so you might have to start working with that to work with other people. And Matthew chapter 10 is a perfect example. And so there's plenty of other pearls. Case in point, no use in keep hammering it over. I think I've done enough.